life's extreme as you want to make it!
Kind of.
You want to talk about that?
You guys are recording the album now. Where are you recording it and how are you recording it?
So we are recording in my tiny home trailer studio, which has been my home for almost 3 years now, full time. We'll actually stay tuned because we're going to give you like a full MTV Cribs tour of the trailer later.
Hey!
And I'll teach you how to shit in the desert. I'm going to take a shit.
Very important knowledge. Pack out your TP, kids. And we're also in Sedona, which is a beautiful part of Arizona. We're here late October, early November, which is like perfect weather season here. Yeah, it's great. Love the desert. And
The energy is good.
Is palpable. Yeah, this is the first LP that has been done in the studio trailer, actually. Foundation of Bones was the first release that I've produced inside the trailer, and now this is the first LP. Everything except for drums is being recorded and mixed and engineered inside the trailer.
Yeah, and I flew out a week ago and I've just been rigging up with Gabe and shitting in the woods and recording vocals and eating lizards.
He's vegan. He's not.
I'm not eating lizards.
He eats vegan lizards.
The chocolate ones. The dark chocolate lizards.
I just heard some of the new tracks from the record you guys are writing. It sounds like you guys are switching up styles, kind of experimenting with some different sounds. Do you want to talk about or touch on your goal for this record and, you know, where you see it going?
I think that for us, we really wanted to push outside of the boundaries of what we were known for and what we like kind of already like mastered in a sense, and push more towards what we were capable of, but also something that, you know, just pushed us past our limits to where we could naturally grow, because we didn't want to just design a soundscape that was artificial. We needed to kind of like let it come naturally, and I think on Luciferous we wanted to start pushing towards that, but it didn't happen in a natural way, so we ended up just going with what felt natural, and that's what Luciferous ended up being. And so I feel like Luciferous was like a stepping stone towards us growing as musicians and kind of being able to branch out and add in those like styles that we've, you know, kind of been holding on to and waiting for an opportunity to use.
And yeah, to add to the style remarks that Dan just made, it's the stuff we're adding, it's stuff that we all, styles of metal and music that we all love and enjoy and have been wanting to include. We've finally gotten there, I guess, naturally, like without it being forced, without, you know, really, overthinking it or overdoing it or anything like that. And to add to the natural sentiments, this was like the kind of the first time where we started with, I think, like a totally blank canvas with songs. Like Luciferous, we had like a handful of demos and riffs ready to go. And this time it was when we started writing last July of 2019 that we started with absolutely nothing, a totally blank canvas and a blank mind, and just these songs all came together very, very organically. And we're pretty, pretty stoked on how things are shaping up.
And as far as like new vocal styles and stuff, I've been wanting to like implement these kind of styles for a long time, but the instrumentation never really called for it, and I think that's part of like the natural approach is always never like doing something that feels artificial or never feel like doing something that feels forced. And for these parts, like, it just like as soon as I would hear them, like Gabe would write, you know, a song, and then like I'd start demoing, and then naturally within the flow of the song I would just hear a part and be like, oh shit, this is, you know, this is a good time to whip out, you know, this technique and try something, you know, completely new and different. And at first in the demo process, it was really scary because I'd demo it out and then I'd be like, all right, here we go. And I'm going to send it to the boys and they're probably going to tell me how much this sucks. And then, you know, I sent some things and then Gabe was like, this is sick. Hell yeah. And then I was like, all right, like this is, you know, this is confidence. This is, you know, like I feel comfortable moving forward. So it was just like a completely natural process. And like, for me, like my favorite albums, you know, that I've ever been involved with were the ones that, yeah, they took effort and work, but they just like naturally came together and it feels like it was meant to be. And I feel like that's what's cool about this record is it feels very like meant to be and natural.
You guys are self-producing, self-engineering, self-mixing, mastering the whole album. What made you guys go that direction with this album?
The foundation of Bones EP, that EP was a big stepping stone for us from Luciferous to where we are now, self-producing a full LP. And, you know, coming home from the whole COVID thing and from touring and then not being very uncertain with things and then just deciding just to say, hey, fuck it, let's self-produce this EP and see how it sounds and see how it goes. And we were all stoked with the product and you just decided to keep moving forward and developing our, you know, self-production skills. And it's great for us because now we can put out music whenever we want. We don't have to, you know, pay a lot of money to go to producer or anything like that. And we're 100% in control of the sound. If it doesn't sound the way we want it to, it's only got ourselves to blame.
Yeah. And the best part about it is like even just tracking vocals with Gabe now, it's like, we both know what we want the song to sound like. And so working with another producer, it's like, he doesn't really know what it's supposed to sound like and what the intent is behind the music. And so there's a lot of conflict. And like, also, if you go to an already established producer, he's gonna have his way of doing things and he's not gonna wanna like stray far off of from what he, like his formula of what he has for success, you know? And with, you know, like Gabe and I working together, it's like I can be there and be like, hey, I want this to sound beefier like this. And even though I don't have the words to say it, he'll be like, you mean like this? And I'll be like, yeah. Beef. And then like just bouncing stuff back and forth and comes up with like better solutions to problems. And on top of that, it's like since Gabe is, you know, mixing and mastering and, you know, we all have input, direct input, basically, I mean, the fact that we're all involved in the project and invested emotionally and all the work that we put into it, we know it's going to be a better product because we're all invested in the project. When for instance, even a top producer is, you know, he might just be bored or not like the project personally and might not put the extra little, you know, sprinkles on top for the album to be as polished as we want it.
We want to talk more on the new dynamics of the band and how everything's going.
Yeah, so, I mean, if you look at our Wikipedia page, our member change-up has been, you know, a lot since the start, since 6 years ago. And, I mean, a lot of that has to do with, for instance, when we first started, we were just an online band, and then we just threw together the fastest lineup we could, and then that kind of ended up falling apart because, you know, it's just like dating, you know. Some people just don't fit, like, emotionally, personally. Some people can't handle touring. Some people want to make more money at their job, or some people are just really shitty people. Not going to name any names. But, yeah, so basically, you know, we went through some lineup changes, and most recently BJ has stepped down, and, you know, he's doing his, you know, family stuff and taking care of the kids and, you know, working hella hours at his new job. And so since then, we haven't really wanted to pick up another guitar player. We don't really need to. I remember back in the day when we first started, BJ was actually asking me, like, yo, who should we ask to do, like, lead guitar stuff? And I was like, yo, Gabe from Delusions of Grandeur. I was like, he's, like, the sickest. I was like, his leads and like his songwriting is just fucking so good. And then I was like, but he's really busy with his band, so I doubt he'd even do it. And lo and behold, Gabe like jumped on halfway through a tour. He just like learned all the songs, jumped on tour with us because the guy who was doing leads for us at the time didn't even learn the set before a tour. So we had to, and Gabe just jumped in and then fucking slayed it. And we were like, yo, you want to join the band? And he was like, hell yeah. Some stuff, and
I had to take care of some things. We don't
take care of some things.
It's taken care of.
It's taken care of. We're like, fuck it. And then that all happened, and then you know we had Aaron O'Toole on drums for a while, and he was great. Loved him. He loves us. All that, and then he decided to pursue drum teaching full time. So we supported his decision, and we were like, all right, fuck you. But I'm just kidding. We were like,
we love Aaron. Yeah, he's awesome.
Yeah, we were just like, all right, we support you. And then dudes in Carnifex mentioned our dude Brandon, mm-hmm. and he just came in and slayed it solid. And he kind of looks like Aaron too. Yeah. A little taller, thicker beard, but
less hair.
Less hair.
He has less hair, but a thicker beard.
Yes. Okay. So, yeah. Uh-huh. I don't know, this is kind of, for me, this is like the most solid lineup. Everyone just gets along so well. There's never any drama. If there is, it's just like over something. Do we have drama? I don't think we have drama.
No, we never really had anything crazy. And if there's anything like inevitable, like, you know, moment where it's like shit goes wrong or something happens,
yeah,
we're able to calmly work through it.
Yeah, we just have a powwow and then we all talk it out and eat Taco Bell together again.
I think the maddest like I ever got was like, you like spilled that beer on me when I was in the bottom bunk, and like that was it.
Oh yeah, that wasn't it was my fault.
That was it. That's seriously it.
I got my karma because when I was in the bottom bunk, the window leaked and poured all into my bed.
Oh yeah.
But yeah.
The basement's flooded.
That was horrible. Yeah. But and so the lineup's solid. Everyone plays their instruments very well. We're all best friends, and you never want to. Never want to read any of our group chats. That's classified.
No one's group chat is safe.
Yeah. But I think that's it. I mean, everyone's fucking sick.
So now that you guys are changing up the style a little bit and adding some different types of material to the new album, how do you think the OG fans are going to take the new sounds?
I'm pretty optimistic about that, actually. I mean, thankfully, we have an awesome fan base that's, pretty dedicated and open. For the most part, open-minded. I mean, it's metal. You're always going to have those fans that, wish we would, or the band does stuff like the first album or whatever. But I think a good sign was on the Foundation of Bones EP when we did the acoustic version of There's No Tomorrow with Dan and myself singing. And it was received very well by our fan base. Like, really, it was great. And so if they were open to that and enjoyed that, then I think they'll really enjoy what we're cooking up right now.
Yeah, for me, I think the ones that are like, oh, this fucking sucks, fuck them, those are the fans we don't want anyway. So they'll get weeded out, and then we'll get new ones that are like, more interested in like the newer qualities of the new stuff, that they'll replace them. Because, I mean, over the years, like, there's always been the set of fans that are like, yeah, your new record, but Patient Zero, bro. And it always goes in cycles, too. So, like, when we released Patient Zero, everyone was like, dude, Patient Zero is cool, but, like, the EP, bro.
It'll always
And be then good. Embodiment came out, and then it was like, but Patient Zero, bro. And then Luciferous comes out, and then some kids are like, dude, Embodiment? And honestly, I fucking hate Embodiment. But just for the record. I think I'm optimistic, too. And honestly, I think we're at the point where we don't even give a fuck because we love the record. Like, me just, I like recorded the song that we recorded yesterday and I was listening to it on my phone before bed and I was just like smiling in bed like, yeah. So I think, I don't even give a fuck. Like, I'm happy with it so far, and honestly, if no one likes it, then what the fuck ever.
And if I had anything to say to any fans that may like doubt our you know what we're doing, like incorporating more clean vocals and singing and widening like the songwriting approach and structure, it's I would just say, like, just know that, like, we would not release any music that we don't stand behind 110%. Everything that we've put out over the past couple of years, we stand behind 110%, and we wouldn't put out music that we didn't back, like, in full.
Yeah, and I think the way all the cleans and stuff like that came into play with this record it happened so naturally that we couldn't not do them, I feel like.
It was calling for them. And I guess like my songwriting approach is just to let the song write itself. We are but mere vessels for the musical ether energy, whatever. And just kind of let it happen.
we're tapping into the Akashic Records.
Yes. Let me tap into this stuff. We're in Sedona. There's crystals everywhere and, you know, all that shit. So,
is that a toucan?
Toucan Sam.
Just keister to crystal.
Keister to crystal.
How many tracks are going to be on the new album?
So we have 14 in total. 12 full songs and then two interludes. Ending outro, kind of just chill instrumental, you know, thing to conclude the album. But we have over an hour's worth of music. It's the biggest musical work any of us have ever been a part of. And
yeah,
it's safe to say we have never put so much work and energy into something like this. And hopefully that's, hopefully you, the fans, enjoy that when this is released.
Yeah, I got crow's feet now.
I feel like that's what it needed, something just to...
It's sexy.
Oh, Lord have mercy.
Hey, eyes up here, boys.
Come back up. Yeah. We got, what are those? Skin condoms.
Yeah, those condoms? That's a condom cabinet. Yeah. Dude, people know what condoms
are. Pull it out, put one on.
What are you pulling?
That's that skin.
I guess we'll have to wait till the mixes are done.
Oh yeah, they went all out.
Well, he had cab access.
Yeah, it's cheap.
They were just jerks though.
And so sexy.
Let me see your hot wood, Gabe. Give us that hot wood, boy.
What are those potatoes called?
On this album, you guys decided to self-produce, write, and engineer the whole thing. Is there a reason behind that, or what's the motivation to do everything in-house for you guys?
Well, it kind of came out of almost necessity. With the last EP, Foundation of Bones, we decided to do an impromptu EP, didn't really have a budget to go to a producer. So we just said, fuck it, let's do it ourselves and, you know, put some real energy into it and effort and see what happens. And we were stoked with the product, so after being excited with the EP, we decided, hey, let's just do the LP. Everything's in our control, ball's in our court. If it doesn't sound the way we want it to, we have no one to blame but ourselves. And it's been great. I really enjoy production work. I've been enjoying improving my skills and, you know, developing our sounds and stuff like that. So yeah, and we have plans that continue self-producing going forward. So, and yeah, everything's done in the tiny home trailer, with the exception of drums. That'll be done at Jason Sukoff's studio at Audio Hammer Studios in Florida.
So what's your writing process been like on this album?
It's been the most extensive we've had so far. It's actually started in July of 2019. Got a bunch of demos out. Dan did some vocals. And it's carried all the way up until about 2 months ago, until we started tracking the album. I mean, everything's been written inside the trailer in various locations out here in the Southwest for instrumentation. And yeah, it's been great. It's the first LP that that I've personally written in my home, in my tiny home trailer. And yeah, it's been awesome. Just kind of just recording, living, you know, outside at camp with my dog and, yeah, just making some fun tunes.
What about the production process? Is there something you've done a lot different this time than your past projects, or what's your actual technical process been like?
Sure. Technical process really hasn't been too different from the standard process for creating an album. You know, everything, guitars and bass were just tracked direct, or bass was tracked direct, guitars through my Kemper and direct. I guess nothing too crazy from a normal recording process, production process, except, you know, we're doing it outside in off-grid locations versus an actual studio in a town or a city or something like that. So yeah, nothing too crazy. It's just same things, just different place.
Has there been any major challenges getting the production done
in the place you're doing it, in your tiny home.
The biggest challenge is handling all the dust that covers my equipment all the time. Other than that, not so much. I've been in my home for about 3 years now, so I know the room and my speakers pretty well, which is pretty important to, you know, knowing how things are supposed to sound from a mixing and production standpoint, is knowing your room and knowing your equipment. Having lived in there for 3 years, I know what, at least I think I know what things are supposed to sound like in there, and not much more to it.
What advice would you want to give to somebody that wanted to do more off the grid living, but still have a modern production life, still edit photos, edit videos, produce music in their rig? What type of things would you suggest or advise?
Any off grid home or lifestyle comes, you have to make compromises and sacrifices, because you can't really have it all. An example, I have a 7x16 trailer, which it allows me to like store all my equipment and have like open space and whatnot, but it's also a big heavy trailer that it, you know, I have to tow around everywhere, as opposed to like having a van where it's more compact. If you're just editing photos or video and you don't need like a decent room for audio, then maybe you just need like a van conversion, but for me, I needed like more space. But yeah, anyone looking to get into this lifestyle and, you know, make a professional career out of it, just weigh the pros and cons and build the rig that, you know, suits your needs the best.
What are some of your current favorite tools, plugins, and techniques you've been using on your productions?
As you can imagine, it's a small space, so everything in there is digital. I don't really have like any outboard gear or anything like that. So everything's done in the box inside the laptop. So I have my Kemper for guitar tones, for most of the guitar tones on this album, using the Fortin Meshuggah profile currently. I love Fortin products. They sound mean and just comfortable playing. For bass, we're using Neural DSP's Dark Glass B7K plugin. Again, fantastic plugin. You don't really need, right now, we don't need much more than that. And then vocals, we are using something new. We're using the Slate ML1 mic, because before, when we were deciding what mic we wanted to get, preamps, compressors, all this stuff, you know, that can add up quick in terms of gear rental. And then we came across the Slate ML1 mic, which is a mic emulator. So the mic itself sounds fantastic just alone. But you can emulate, like a Telefunken or a Neumann, or there's countless mics, or not countless, I don't know, there's like 20 or 30 total, something like that you can emulate. And it sounded great for Dan's voice, and obviously not as good as having the actual physical piece of gear in your hands, but in our situation where we're in a tiny space on a low budget, we're fortunate enough to live in a day and age where the analog to digital software is just so damn good that it makes what we do easier, and we can get a commercially viable product with a laptop and a set of speakers. So,
any favorite VSTs or soft synths?
Been using Serum a lot for a lot of the synths on this record. I love all the Fab Filter plugins. I use a bunch of Waves ones. The Slate Mix Rack is awesome as well. I use that very frequently. And I use a lot of stock Cubase plugins as well. There's a lot of great stock Cubase plugins that are awesome, that are low CPU as well. So it's all, you know, just trying to make the best of the tools that you have.
All right, how about guitars and instruments? What type of...
So for guitars, the 8-string songs, we are using my new Aristides 08OS. One of the best guitars I've ever played. They're a fantastic company to work with as well. And my Strictly 7 Solar model, like circa 2012, when they were still making the good ones, for the 7-string songs. And for bass, we are using a Dingwall NG2, one of the best basses in the world, in my humble opinion. And all those instruments are a big part of our sound on this record.